I'm going to be providing some background and data on the state's initiative to help form a basis of understanding for the state's efforts to address intergenerational poverty. In 2012, the Utah legislature passed the Intergenerational Poverty Mitigation Act to determine whether or not the state had an issue of families experiencing intergenerational poverty. In that first piece of legislation, the Department of Workforce Services was required to establish data to determine whether or not there was ongoing use of public assistance benefits that passed from one generation to the next. Then, in 2013, the legislature amended the Intergenerational Poverty Mitigation Act and established two administrative entities, the Intergenerational Welfare Reform Commission and the Intergenerational Poverty Advisory Committee. And through these entities, the state is evaluating extensive data that is revised every year to determine strategies and policies to address intergenerational poverty. The effort around intergenerational poverty really evolves from providing opportunity for children experiencing intergenerational poverty to make sure that the cycle of poverty ends as they become adults. This quote from Abraham Lincoln really captures what this effort is really about, which is ensuring all children, regardless of where they are born or their status at birth, have equal opportunity to strive into adulthood. Although Utah's economy continues to improve and the state's unemployment rate is one of the lowest in the nation, we're still seeing that there are large numbers of children in Utah who are living in poverty. This slide represents the rates of children and adults living in poverty in the state of Utah and how that compares to the national rate. And what's unique about Utah is that we are in much better shape and we have a much lower child poverty rate than the nation, which provides great opportunity for us to address the challenges of poverty in our state. Utah's 2015 child poverty rate was 13%. But when we look at intergenerational poverty, we're using a measure that is not the same as the federal poverty measure. Utah is the only state in the nation that has embarked on addressing and reducing intergenerational poverty, and as a result of that, has established its own definition of intergenerational poverty and its own measure of how to define and identify families and children experiencing intergenerational poverty. It's incredibly important to understand how Utah defines intergenerational poverty as a basis for understanding the data that we will go through in the next several slides. This slide, entitled "Who is in Intergenerational Poverty," identifies the four groups of individuals that the state is measuring data against to see their progress, track their progress going forward. The top line represents all the adults in Utah who are receiving public assistance in 2015. And when you look at these four adults, you'll see that one is highlighted. That one adult represents adults who are receiving public assistance currently in 2015, who also received public assistance when they were children. And this is roughly 25% of Utah's public assistance population. When we look at the next level of individuals, that row reflects the children. And we see that there are 57,602 highlighted children. Those represent children of the adults who are experiencing intergenerational poverty. And in Utah, we have identified these kids as children experiencing intergenerational poverty. But we don't only look at those 57,000 children. We also look at the children of the adults who are currently receiving public assistance, but of whom we do not have childhood record that they received public assistance when they were kids. And those children total 234,151 children in 2015. When we combine the 57,000 children with the 234,000 children, that equates to roughly 33% of Utah's child population. And we look at both of those together and classify all of those children, that 33%, as children who are at risk of remaining in poverty as adults. And we combine that total and look at both groups for two reasons. One, the legislative, the Intergenerational Poverty Mitigation Act requires that the state measurably reduce the incidence of intergenerational poverty amongst Utah children as they become adults, and also focus on children who are at risk of remaining in poverty in order to end that cycle. So we look at the children at risk in total and not simply the 57,000 children experiencing intergenerational poverty. The way Utah identifies these in four groups of individuals is by using public assistance data that the Department of Workforce Services captures. And we look at four public assistance programs to identify these individuals. And those programs are cash assistance, medical assistance, child care subsidies, and food stamps, also known as SNAP. And when we look at the individuals who are receiving public assistance in a particular year within those programs and whether or not they received it as children, that's how we come up with these individuals that we have identified and are tracking. What we've seen so far in the 5 years of reports that the Department of Workforce Services has developed in coordination with the other administrative agencies that are involved in this work, which includes the Department of Human Services, the Department of Health, the Utah State Board of Education, and the juvenile courts, we see that every corner of Utah is impacted and has numbers of children who are at risk of remaining in poverty as they become adults. You can see some areas have greater numbers than others, but there is not a single county that doesn't have children who are at risk of remaining in poverty. The legislation requires that the state focus on the children and reduce the incidence of intergenerational poverty for Utah's kids. As a result of that requirement, the data that's analyzed is analyzed in four areas of child well-being depicted in this infographic of the House. And we look at these four areas of child well-being because research tells us that when a child has these areas addressed fully, they are more likely to succeed into adulthood. And those four areas are early childhood development, education, family economic stability, and health. And you can see in the infographic of the House that there are a number of indicators and measures that have been identified that the state is keeping track of with its coordinated efforts across the five agencies working to address intergenerational poverty. As we move on to analyzing some of the data that's included in the report, it's important to note that the annual reports that are released every fall have a much more extensive list of data that is important to become familiar with for any community that wants to address intergenerational poverty. But I'm just going to highlight some of those data points for you today. Although the effort requires the state to measurably reduce the incidence of poverty amongst Utah children, we know that children are growing up in families with parents. And if parents are unable to meet the basic needs of their children, those children are more likely to remain in poverty into adulthood. So we do look at some indicators that are related to the parents. The first one we have is the educational attainment of the parents experiencing intergenerational poverty. We know in the modern economy that it's extremely difficult to earn a wage sufficient to meet the basic needs of the family with an education that ends with a high school diploma. So we look at the data for educational attainment for the intergenerational poverty adults, and what we have found is that 72% of these adults lack an education beyond high school. They've either dropped out or ended their formal education years at high school. That presents challenges for many families, as I said, in the modern economy, to meet the basic needs of their families. And we're seeing that as we look down to the next two pieces of data. First, whether or not they're maintaining a consistent foothold in the labor market. And what we're seeing is that 33% of the intergenerational poverty adults worked the entire year of 2015. That's only a third of those adults who worked throughout the entire year. But what we've seen is that there is sporadic attachment to the labor force for about 62% of the intergenerational poverty adults. So almost two-thirds of the intergenerational poverty adults had some employment in 2015. This piece of data dispels the myth that people experiencing poverty don't want to work. When we see that two-thirds of the adults have some employment, it indicates that there's a desire to work, there's a desire to meet the needs of the family, but for whatever reason, these individuals cannot maintain consistent employment or obtain wages sufficient to meet the needs of their families. And when we look at the average wage of these intergenerational poverty adults in over since 2013 to 2015, when the economy has been growing in Utah, we've seen a slight uptick in wages for the intergenerational poverty adults. But when we look at all the intergenerational poverty adults, we're still seeing that their annual wages average about $13,423 in the year 2015. It's slightly higher for the males in intergenerational poverty and slightly lower for the females experiencing intergenerational poverty. And combined, when you look at the educational attainment, their ability to maintain employment throughout a year and their annual wages, we can get a better picture as to why they are continuing to utilize public assistance benefits. Now we're going to shift to the outcomes for the children. We've spent some time talking about the importance of educational attainment, which brings the issue of of education for the kids and the importance of education for the kids into a very bright light. And when we start with the graduation rates of these intergenerational poverty kids, we're seeing that only 59% of them are graduating from high school. That compares to 83% of all Utah students who graduate from high school. So there's a big gap between the graduation rates of the intergenerational poverty students and all students in total. And when we look at some of the other educational indicators, which are included in the annual report, indicators like chronic absence rates and third grade reading proficiency and eighth grade math, we're seeing that the intergenerational poverty students are struggling and experiencing some challenges to academic success that reveals itself very early on in their formal education. Third grade reading and eighth grade math proficiency scores are important benchmarks to determine whether or not a child is on track for graduating from high school. And unfortunately, we're seeing very low proficiency rates in both third grade reading and eighth grade math among the intergenerational poverty student population. The other area of child well-being we look at in addition to education is health. And the data around health is very interesting. We know that the vast majority, 94% of the children experiencing intergenerational poverty have access to public health care. They're either having that access through the traditional Medicaid program or for the Child Health Insurance Program, also known as CHIP. We're also seeing that almost three quarters of their parents, 72% of their parents, have access to public health insurance. But we're not seeing high utilization rates. In other words, they've got the insurance, but we're not seeing them visiting the doctor as frequently as we would like. And there could be many reasons for that. Whether or not there's access to doctors who are taking public health insurance, the distance to travel to a doctor. The data doesn't tell us why there isn't utilization. It just shows us that there is a lag in the amount of health utilization that these families are receiving. One of the areas that's of great concern in the health area is behavioral health. We know that children who experience trauma in early childhood and adverse childhood experiences, including poverty, are more likely to have long-term impacts from that trauma and adverse childhood experiences. Impacts including increases of risky behavior, substance use, heart disease, diabetes, into adulthood. So we pay particular attention to what types of trauma children may be experiencing. And one of those areas is incidents of substantiated cases of childhood abuse and neglect. And this is a very revealing piece of data. Once you understand the relationship between early childhood trauma and the long-term implications through adulthood. And what we're seeing are incredibly high rates of substantiated cases of childhood abuse and neglect among the intergenerational poverty population. And we see that among the intergenerational poverty adults, 29% of those adults were victims of a substantiated case of abuse and neglect when they were children. And a substantiated case is one in which an investigator has gone in, investigated the claim, and found out that, in fact, there has been an incidence of abuse and neglect. And 29% is much higher than the statewide rate of about anywhere from 1.2% to 1.5%. And we're seeing that in all the intergenerational poverty groups, that the rate is much higher than the statewide rate. For the children, almost a quarter of them have been victims of a substantiated case of abuse and neglect. And amongst the young adult population experiencing intergenerational poverty, those are 18 to 21-year-olds, 35% of them have been victims of a substantiated case of abuse and neglect. So we know that what can evolve from being a victim of abuse and neglect is long-term health conditions, both behavioral and physical health conditions, including need for increased mental health services. So these higher rates are cause for alarm and paying particular focus to. This data provides just a snapshot of the data that's available through the state of Utah's analysis on intergenerational poverty. As I mentioned earlier, there's an annual report that's put out every fall by October 1st that provides comprehensive data, statewide data, in all of these areas of child well-being with all of the indicators. I would encourage you to look at that report and become familiar with that report. We also encourage you to take a deeper dive in your local data. The Department of Workforce Services will be preparing county-level data for every county in the state so that local communities and counties can take this data and address intergenerational poverty at the local level. Communities are encouraged to utilize the training modules provided by Utah State University to establish local committees to begin understanding this issue at the local level and begin developing strategies and plans to reduce intergenerational poverty in your communities. The Department of Workforce Services is available to assist you in your communities to develop plans and strategies to address intergenerational poverty. If you need any assistance in understanding this data, please contact us at the Department of Workforce Services, jobs.utah.gov.